Welcome to 100 Songs. This is episode 89, and we're talking about the Mighty Slayer and the song South of Heaven off of the album of the same name. Came out in 1988. It was my introduction to Slayer. I was in high school, and I remember hearing Slayer for the first time. And the very first song I ever heard from them was South of Heaven, which is partly why I chose this song on my 100 songs list. Again, love a lot of Slayer songs. I actually prefer the faster stuff, the thrashy stuff. But South of Heaven, the way that I discovered this band through that song, and I was so blown away when I heard, the whole intro and the whole song. I was just mesmerized, like truly mesmerized, and proceeded to, take in the rest of this particular album. Totally loved it, and I was like a huge fan immediately. And then, of course, went backwards in the catalog, and then eagerly awaited each of the subsequent albums that came out. So, yeah, it was in 88. So an album came out. I caught on 88 or 89. I don't remember exactly when, but it was this album. And like I said, the opening, super powerful, the opening chord or notes, the dun 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 dun, it's pretty much got my attention. And then with the drums kick in, and then Tom kicks in, and then from there it's just magical. Love it, totally love it. South of Heaven as an album offers a dark look into humanity and its inevitable spiral downward. It's an awful and pessimistic vision, for sure, and I love every second of it. Their lyrics are so over the top, and when I was a teenager, I just ate it up. I'm like, wow, this is really awful. In a good way, I can't believe they're singing about these types of things, and I don't know, it got my attention, I guess. And the sound of this record too, I'm quite fond of. I know not everybody probably likes it, but I really enjoy the left and right channel being separated, so you have Kerry King in one ear guitar, and you have Jeff Hanneman in another ear guitar. Drums and bass are centered. So when they would switch off doing solos, you would hear the guitar in one ear, and then it would switch to the guitar in the other ear, which I just thought was fantastic at the time. I used to sit at my stereo, and I would do full balance left, and then listen to the song or the album. And then I'd switch it to listen to the right channel. And it was kind of a weird thing to do, but I thought it was really cool. It gave it definitely gave it a different perspective. Slayer formed in 1982 in Huntington Park by Kerry King and Jeff Hanneman, the aforementioned two guitar players. Sadly, Jeff Hanneman is no longer with us. He was I think he was the single biggest creative arm of Slayer, and wrote a lot of the best guitar parts. I like Kerry King too, don't get me wrong, but I think Jeff Hanneman, the band is really never the same without him. I still appreciate Slayer for what they are, but once Jeff Hanneman went, this band kind of went for me, and it was sort of a different band without him. Hardcore alcoholic, essentially drank himself to death, which is really tragic. Anyway, they recruit Tom Araya, of course, vocals and bass, and the fantastic Dave Lombardo, who was a drummer that I really got to appreciate, and has done so much with Slayer, but also on his own as well. They would become one of the most influential thrash bands, metal bands, unrelenting, brutal, dark, established a cult following early on. I would say Rain and Blood is when their production value really picked up. I like those early albums too, the ones before it. But Rain and Blood, again, saw a big improvement in production quality, I think, thanks to Rick Rubin. And it became an instant classic. South of Heaven was a little bit of a direction change for the band. I mean, Rain and Blood is just, it's like about 30 minutes. And it just kicks the shit out of you and never lets up. It is a thrash album, pure and through, and it's incredible. It's you know, it's a classic, like I said. And South of Heaven slowed things down a little bit, different kind of structure, different feel. I think some of the hardcore fans maybe were not as appreciative initially. I, for one, you know, this is where I grew up. I grew up at South of Heaven. So to me, I think it's fantastic. But they just, you know, just changed their sound a little bit. Over the years, we're not going to go through the whole discography, but over the years, there were some lineup changes. I think most significantly early on, well, the only one early on was Dave Lombardo. He was the beginning of the lineup changes. So he went out of the band and they got, I think it was Paul Bostoff originally. Was he the first replacement? Is he the only replacement? I should have got that square. And then he did come back, and then, went away again. And I'm not sure what all the drama is. I mean, I'm aware of some of it, but, Dave Lombardo in and out of the band, in middle slash later years. And then when Jeff Hanneman died, they had another guitarist come in and tour and do an album, I think, right? And then they wrapped it up in 2019, basically retired as a band, and so that's it, we're done. Now, of course, that's not true, because fast forward to now, and they are touring again, or they were about to tour again. They're back, and didn't think it was going to happen, but really, can you be surprised when these things happen? I don't think that you can. Live wise, I've seen Slayer a whole bunch of times, so I'm going to share. I went through my concert tickets. I'm going to share with you those. Actually, before I do that, let's listen to South of Heaven. This one, I think I want to start from the very beginning and just play the beginning part of the song, because I remember hearing this and just being blown away. So here we go. South of Heaven. Mostly over here. Now that kicks in on this side. It's a great riff. We'll be right back. this album was the first time I really heard some of those killer drum fills. Or killer drum fills in general. So that's about the first minute and a half. It goes on for another few minutes, and from there, another thing I really liked about the song that really got my attention too was the very, very end. So it goes into this really long held guitar note. Well, there's no reason we can't hear it. And then it goes right into silent scream, which goes, you know, into their sort of breakneck thrash. Let me fast forward it. Yeah, so back it up a little bit. Song's essentially over. And they just hold this note, and I love it. Start to build. Yeah, so I don't have the album teed up, but just the song. So it goes right into Silent Scream. Fantastic. All right. So concert-wise, the first time I saw Slayer was in the Exhibition Hall in downtown Sacramento on J Street. March 10th, 1991. So that's a long way back. But it was 1991. That was the first time I saw them. The second time I saw them was 4 years later. No, it wasn't. That's not true. It was 2 months later. 2 months later as part of Clash of the Titans, Arco Arena. I used to call it Echo Arena. It's where all the bands came. Clash of the Titans. It was the big metal show. You know, they call it the Big Three now or Big Four. Slayer was part of that bill. I think they rotated the headliner, but Clash of the Titans. So 2 months later, I got to see them again, which is incredible. Now, fast forward another 3 years, and once again, Arco Arena, January 22nd, 1995. So, at this point, I was in college or something. Trying to finish school, I think. Fast forward again another 3 years, and I saw them at the Memorial Auditorium in downtown Sacramento. J Street again, it's a different venue. Fear Factory. How cool is that? 1998. Fear Factory, Slayer. It's pretty badass. And then the final and fifth time I saw them was in 2002. So over 20 years ago was the fifth and final time. Las Vegas, House of Blues. August 5th, 2002, Slayer and Soulfly, Blood Soulfly. So, I happened to be in Vegas. I wasn't planning on going to the show, but I saw it and was like, well, I have to go to that. So I did. And I loved it. I have not seen them since, but, Slayer, 100 songs. I had a couple of things from them, memorabilia type things, and I don't have either anymore. It really bums me out. So they had a CD for a single, Seasons in the Abyss, and it was a blood pack. I think you can probably Google it and see it. But I bought it, and it was the most gimmicky thing ever. It was a CD holder, regular size CD holder, but it was plastic and it was filled with blood. And I think it had like little Slayer symbol discs in there or skulls or something. I should have got a picture of it. And they float around in this blood. It was a blood pack, blood digipack or something like that, or blood pack. And the whole thing, you know, open like a regular CD, but it was like this vinyl plastic thing. It was a single. Yeah, it was for a single. So it wasn't for the album. It was for the single. And it dried up eventually. Like a whole bunch of years later, the blood disappeared and it just looked weird. And like an asshole, I threw it out. Or I gave it away, or I sold. Maybe I sold it. I don't remember what the hell happened to it, but it is gone. And that would have been cool to have. You know, that's over 20 years old now. That album came out, what, 1990 or something? Seasons of the Abyss? I don't know, but something like that. Yeah, I threw it away like an asshole. The other thing, even worse, was I bought an album, a CD, and they were at Tower Records in Sacramento, in Citrus Heights. And the whole band was there, so I went and stood in line, and I got my CD that had just come out. Pretty sure Paul Bostoff was the drummer. And I brought my CD, and I met all of them. The whole band was there. They all signed my CD. And I don't have it anymore. I don't know what happened to it. They didn't sign the CD. They signed the book. You know, the book that comes with the CD. I had all their signatures on there. And again, like an asshole, I lost it. Or something happened to it. I don't have it anymore. I would love to be able to hold it up and be like, check this out. Look what I got. But nope. I don't have it. So two things from this band. And I like stuff like that, you know. I show some of it on these episodes, and I have neither of those things, but I'll never forget it. It's a bummer, though. So, Slayer, check it out. You're already a fan, or you're not. I mean, let's face it. Let's go to the wheel and see what's next. Okay, next up, Iron Maiden. My entry into metal, my favorite band of the late 80s, early 90s, love this band to death, and we're going to take a look at Hallowed Be Thy Name, a live version, because it's such a good live version, off the Beast of Hammersmith. We're going to talk about that next time. Thanks.